Hi guys, this is David Kwan here, and here's another video about an argument that a person who is against gay marriage would bring up, and here's my kind of counter-response to it. This one's kind of tricky, actually. It's a bit more hairier than some of the other arguments, but it is kind of related to the last argument that I talked about, but this one's about a religious liberty. And so, imagine this scenario. Let's say that there is this Muslim guy who owns a wedding bakery shop. So he's a business owner, and this Muslim, of course, he's a devout Muslim who believes that homosexuality is a sin and an affront against God, and therefore is obviously against gay marriage. And he owns a wedding bakery shop. So he makes cakes and delivers cakes for weddings, pretty much. And so let's have this guy. And then let's say that gay marriage becomes legalized in the United States. All across the United States, and ROMA is passed, and now, you know, all the legal benefits and federal benefits that come with marriage are afforded to gay married couples. Let's say that happens. So in this scenario, let's also say that there is this gay couple in the same neighborhood as this guy who owns a wedding bakery shop. The married couple plans to get married, and they call this guy up and say, "Hey, we love your wedding cakes. We've heard great things about it. My partner and I, and we're gay. We're planning to get married, and we're gonna have the ceremony on this date at this location. And we want to order your awesome cake. How much does it cost?" The Muslim guy is just like, "Wait, what? You are gay, and you're ordering cake from me? No, that's not going to happen. You see, my religion says that's wrong. I'm sorry, but I can't sell my cake to you." In a case like that, if gay marriage has been totally legalized across the board, across all the United States, that's kind of accepted. That does recognize acceptance of homosexuality by legal definition also. So I'm thinking further laws down the road will make it so that what this Muslim guy is doing is kind of discriminatory and is illegal. So if a separate law is made, and I'm pretty sure it will be made if gay marriage is legalized, if separate laws are made in which what this Muslim guy is doing is considered illegal or discriminatory, is that a violation of religious liberty? And that's the question. If it is a violation of religious liberty, then holy crap, that's a really big compelling argument against gay marriage. Even I will admit that's a pretty awesome, that's pretty good point, right there. It's just like, hey, you're against gay marriage because it might violate religious liberty? All right, you got a point there. I'm going to counter that it is not a violation of religious liberty, and I don't want to argue too much on my opinion, but I want to kind of base it on legal precedent. So if we go back to what the Supreme Court had decided on a case like this, that's probably what we'll go by. And so this case was actually brought up. I wasn't aware of the Supreme Court case, but it came up during my really intense discussion in one of my YouTube videos. I commented back and just went back and forth on one of my videos. It's really, really awesome how that discussion unfolded. But somewhere in that discussion, this case came up, and it's Reynolds v. United States. And this occurred in 1878, I believe. It's a case where this guy, George Reynolds, was polygamous, so he had polygamy. At the time, and we still do, United States passed anti-bigamy law, or anti-polygamy law. It was kind of a political move. I mean, United States government was going against the Mormon Church. That was part of the reason for the law. Can't really say, but politically that could be said that was a big reason why it was in place. Anyway, there is an anti-bigamy law that says, it's illegal for a man to marry more than one woman. George Reynolds, being a Mormon, went against that. So that was considered, you know, a criminal act. George Reynolds appealed. The case went all the way up to Supreme Court. And George Reynolds, kind of, his defense was that, you know, this anti-bigamy law was unconstitutional because it violated his religious liberty. You know, it prevented him from having freedom of religion because his belief in his Mormon belief said that polygamy is okay. So this legal law was violating his religion. That was his defense. The court decided that wasn't a good defense. The court decided that no, this anti-bigamy law still respects religious liberty. Because hey, George Reynolds, you can still believe all you want. You still have the religious freedom to believe, that's the key word, to believe that polygamy is okay, that you can marry more than one person. But the conduct of marrying more than one person is not okay. And that's not legal. Therefore, the conduct is going to be considered illegal, but your belief, you're free to believe whatever the hell you want. So it still upholds religious liberty. That was the legal precedent. Further court cases happened, like two more, I think. But those court cases ended up reaffirming that decision. So if we go by that legal precedent, this bakery situation is kind of the same thing. There is this Muslim baker saying that, no, I view homosexuality as a sin. That's my religion, you know. And so I will not serve my cake to these two homosexuals who want to get married because that is my religious freedom. And this is when I think if it goes all the way up to Supreme Court case again, I feel like the result would be the same as Reynolds v. United States. We'll say, hey, look, you're free to believe whatever the hell you want. You're free to believe in your religion saying that homosexuality is a sin. You're free to believe that. But this conduct of discriminating against a gay couple wanting to get married and not serving them cake, you know, that is discriminatory. That should be illegal, that conduct. The law saying that conduct is illegal will remain constitutional. So that's kind of the legal precedent argument. Is it compelling? I can't really say, but that's the argument that I'm going to stick with. We have so much legal precedent for this that I feel like that argument stays. And it's kind of, you know, I guess if you own a business, you want to be able to free, you want to be free to how, you know, what kind of people you hire and what kind of people you want to service to. But because, you know, there is discrimination laws in place, and I don't know, this is a weird, I think it's a bigger debate than just gay marriage. Because if this law assumes that gays and lesbians are going to be under the federally protected class against discrimination, that's currently not in place right now. But I guess I'm hoping, at least, you know, as if gay marriage is legalized, that's the path that the country will be heading to, that gays and lesbians and bisexual and transgender people or transsexual people will be considered as a legally, federally protected class. If that's the case, a Muslim baker selling of the cake to this gay married couple, or about to be married couple actually, saying that's illegal, that would be a perfectly legit law. If, you know, gays and lesbians, LGBT people are considered under the protected class. I think they should be, and I don't think that would violate religious liberty. But if you argue that, and if you can actually, if there is a legal precedent that says this is a total violation of religious liberty, then sure, I guess you got an argument there. But if we look at Supreme Court history, the legal history, I don't think that's going to happen. And I don't think it should. I don't think a discriminating conduct should be approved because of religious belief.